Grace and peace to you in the name of our risen Lord. My name is Reverend Alice Fleming Townley, and I am the bridge pastor at the Presbyterian Church of Okemos. Today, we are celebrating Refugee Awareness Sunday as part of World Refugee Week. During this pandemic, our building is closed and our church is alive and active. Visit our website, okemospres.org, to sign up for email announcements and find ways to participate and give online. Next Sunday, June 21st, I will begin a six-week sermon series on transformation, drawing from Joyce Rupp's book, Open the Door, A Journey to the True Self. This devotional book is available for purchase online and at Schuller's Bookstore in Okemos. Kent Workman and others are developing plans for anti-racism work yet this summer. Contact Kent if you are interested. On Monday, June 22nd, and continuing through Thursday, June 25th, we begin our online Family Vacation Bible School. See our website for more information. We remember in prayer this week those who have been hospitalized, Tombo Bay, and those recovering at home, Diane Allen, Barb Geske, Terry Townley, and Ed Gillespie as he begins treatment for health challenges. We extend heartfelt sympathy to John Dooley Sr. and Judy Gardy and family on the death of John Dooley Jr. And sympathy to Roy Mayland and the Mayland family on the death of Roy's father, Leroy Mayland. and to Dennis Hansen on the death of his stepmother, Thelma Dunn Hansen. May all feel held and sustained in the love of God. Please join us in the call to worship. From many places and circumstances, together we worship God.
With hearts full of gratitude for the beauty of God's creation.
Hearts full of grace from the redeeming work of Jesus Christ.
Hearts full of longing for justice in the world.
We humbly seek hearts full of courage to work tirelessly for the rights of all people.
Hearts full of generosity that we may freely share with others.
Hearts full of compassion to recognize the possibilities within every human being.
Hearts full of wisdom, guided by the Spirit as we seek to live in God's dream.
And now, let us pray. God, beyond borders, we remember that all of humanity is made in your image. We thank you for the opportunity to know you more fully through another, for the friendship of strangers and the richness of other cultures.
Blessed are you, God beyond borders.
But if we have overlooked the exiles in our midst, heightened their exclusion by our indifference, given our permission for a climate of fear and tolerated a culture of violence,
have mercy on us. God, who takes side with justice, confront our prejudice, stretch our narrowness, shift our own laws and lives with the penetrating insight of your Spirit until we embody your desire. Amen.
Hear now the promise of the gospel. The measure of love in the New Testament is how love could bridge barriers that could never be crossed before. Know that you are forgiven and that you have within you God's own Spirit, God's own love, God's own healing power. Amen.
Sight to see them, and lips that we might my turn. How great is God Almighty, who has made all things well. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful. The Lord God made them all.
This morning, our scripture comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 10, beginning with verse 40. Hear now these words. Jesus said, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." Let us pray. Continue to move among us, O Holy One. Convict, convert, consecrate us until we are wholly thine, we pray. Amen. When I was little, our church in Sodus had a potluck on the second Sunday of every month. When we would walk into the fellowship hall, there would be places at the table for everyone. And at the front, there would be very long tables laden with food. Sliced ham, green bean casserole, molded jello salads. And at the end of the table was my very favorite, what I anticipated from month to month. Two heaping trays of fresh, hot egg rolls. In 1979, our church sponsored a refugee family from Vietnam. Word spread and strangers in the community asked, could they also sponsor a family? Why, yes. And so the friendships expanded. Matthew, or Bud, and Jean Borey welcomed Than, who we knew as Tran, and Lap Tran. And we welcomed with them. This week, nearly 40 years later, Tran and Lap's son Stephen and I reminisced for hours. What do you remember from when we were children? Where are you now? During the war in Vietnam, Tran had worked for the United States government as a cartographer, mapping the terrain and showing where enemy territory was. After the war ended and the United States pulled out of Vietnam, Tran remained and was imprisoned. When Tran was released, he and Lap fled by boat. They were taken to the island of Bidong with thousands of other Vietnamese refugees. On the island, food was scarce, and Tran found discarded barrels and foraged wood from the forest and strapped it all together to build a raft that he used to fish. Tran had his United States government credentials and applied for resettlement in the United States.
After about a year of vetting and processing, Tran and Lap arrived in Southwest Michigan. For years, they had dreamed of having a child. And soon after arriving, at ages 45 and 37, Lap learned she was pregnant. I still remember hearing the news that they were expecting and rejoicing greatly at Stephen's birth. Our family sat together in the same pew at church, my mother and Christina and I, with Tran and Lap and then baby Stephen. We watched with delight as Stephen grew and learned to walk. During worship, when sitting still and being quiet got long, we entertained Stephen with pencil drawings of animals on the offering envelopes. After a while, Tran himself was able to sponsor his youngest sister, Hong. And at Hong's wedding, Christina and Stephen walked down the aisle of our church as flower girl and ring bearer. And when Abel Hong sponsored her best friend from Vietnam and her family, Hong and Lap made those heaping trays of egg rolls every month. And at more than one joint family outing, Stephen and I traded egg rolls and bologna sandwiches. The Borey family owned Ace Hardware, and Tran worked at Ace. Lap made lampshades in their home. Tran and Lap both sent as much money as they could to help their families in Vietnam, never feeling they could give quite enough. At the same time, Tran and Lap navigated their lives, languages, food, work, and family in the United States. Incredible. In 1987, our family moved away and circumstances changed and news of one another became slim. As Stephen and I caught up this week, I learned. His father, Tran, worked faithfully at Ace Hardware until retirement. The Tran family and the Borey family came to be like an extended family and shared holidays and support for as long as the Boreys lived. After Lap retired, she returned to Vietnam. And when Lap died, she was living in a Buddhist monastery, serving the poor. Stephen graduated at the top of his class and went on to become a pharmaceutical researcher. Stephen now oversees teams developing new drugs to fight cancer. And Tran lives with Stephen and his beautiful family. Stephen shared, "Sometimes my dad asks, what if I had never gotten on the plane? What if I had never come to St. Joe? Like a flip of a switch, my life would have been so different." Our current refugee resettlement program in the United States started during the era after the Vietnam War. Until recently, the United States State Department resettled an average of 90,000 people per year. This program not only saved lives, but those who came have enriched our communities and saved our lives. The number of refugees who are admitted each year is determined by the U.S. president, and our current one is the first to drastically cut the program, forcing many resettlement offices to close and threatening the very existence of resettlement in the United States. Meanwhile, the numbers of refugees in the world are at an all-time high. Dr. Stephanie Nowen at Michigan State has researched the connection between the rise in white supremacy activity in the United States with the rise in anti-immigrant and anti-refugee policies. The Presbyterian Church of Okemos, our church, has supported refugees since those early years when my United Methodist Church, Chapel Hill in SOTUS, was doing so, along with an entire nation. 10 years ago, with the dream of Judy Harris and the incredible work of Paula France, together we formed and continue supporting the Global Institute of Lansing, GIL. 5 years ago, we gathered faith leaders and directors of our refugee support agencies to create the All Faith Alliance for Refugees, AFAR. The call to welcome the refugee is something all major faiths share in common. AFAR meets regularly to learn refugee updates in our community and brainstorm the best ways to be supportive. The biggest need now is to financially support our refugee resettlement office at St. Vincent Catholic Charities through severe federal cuts. Doing so supports those who have arrived and be able to one day welcome new arrivals again. In doing so, we rise to resist white supremacy. And we rise to live out the call of our faith, the call of our God. Last fall, Hong San drove to my parents' home in South Haven with a gift of egg rolls. We saved them in the freezer and brought them out as a special treat for my father's 80th birthday. You see, these egg rolls and all they represent are more than a favorite food of my childhood. These egg rolls are sacramental. And Jesus said, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me." Amen.
Hello, friends. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Judy Harris. I'm an elder at this church, and I'm Director of Refugee Services for St. Vincent Catholic Charities. I want to start with thanking everyone for participating in this Refugee Sunday event. We have so much going on right now that it's really important to remember that there are so many people still out there who are really vulnerable. According to the United Nations, there are over 71 million people around the world who've been forced from their homes. And almost 30 million of them have fled their countries and are officially refugees. And they are very at risk of illness, natural disasters, and other tragedies. COVID-19 has found them too. In fact, according to the United Nations, 134 refugee hosting countries have reported local transmission of COVID-19. In many cases, refugees live in overcrowded camps and lack access to adequate healthcare, shelter, water, and sanitation, making it very difficult for relief workers and health workers to protect them from disease. According to the International Rescue Committee, coronavirus transmission rates in some of the refugee camps in Greece, Syria, and Bangladesh could be even faster than those seen on some of the cruise ships. But an estimated 80% are sheltered outside of camps, often in overcrowded communities, with little access to healthcare and almost no way to quarantine themselves or practice social distancing. And it looks like resettlement will not be a solution, at least not for the rest of this year. Refugee resettlement was already in a crisis due to policies of the current administration. But with the pandemic, the situation is much worse. So refugees overseas continue to be separated from their families and living in insecure environments, subject to harassment, assault, and poor health conditions. This year was set to have the lowest number of refugees resettled in the U.S. since the beginning of the program over 40 years ago. Only 18,000 refugees were projected to arrive, and most of those were divided up into select groups of people, Under the Obama administration, an average of 85,000 refugees were resettled every year. Then resettlement essentially stopped this past March. Very few refugees have been able to make it through, only emergency cases, and no more are expected through the end of the fiscal year. Less than 7,600 have arrived in the U.S. so far, not even half of the 18,000 target. In Lansing, we haven't seen a new arrival since February. That means that our total number of arrivals in Lansing will end at 57 for the fiscal year. We normally resettle an average of 500 to 600 people. That's a 90% reduction. Meanwhile, refugees here in Lansing continue to be part of the essential workforce. They work in warehouses, food production, stores, manufacturing, hospitals, and nursing homes. At St. Vincent's, we've been very busy working with the folks that we've recently resettled. We started by calling the elderly and medically challenged to educate them about how to protect themselves. By now, we've called or tried to call everyone who arrived in the last 5 years. Just like the rest of us, they are scared. Like the rest of the community, some have tested positive, some have gotten sick, and sadly, some have died. They are also struggling to pay their rent, and we're helping those that have lost their jobs to apply for unemployment. And they're worried about their children's education, hoping that they caught up enough and learned enough English to get them set up to learn on their own from home. St. Vincent's have been working on developing and implementing remote educational programs for refugees, including ESL. And some of our wonderful volunteers have joined together to create a tutor circle to help adults and kids stay engaged and moving forward in learning. We've also partnered with the Ingham County Health Department to provide language support for community coronavirus testing events and to help communicate with patients and their contacts. These past few weeks, resettled refugees in our communities have also been learning lessons on civics. They're watching and often joining their neighbors in the streets protesting against racial injustice, which for some was the very reason they had to flee their country of origin. The images of violence in the news are all too familiar to many refugees, and some are being re-traumatized by what they're seeing. Most refugees resettled in the U.S. can fall into the category of marginalized minorities. 61% of St. Vincent's arrivals over the past 5 years came from Africa. Many trusted and dreamed that they were coming to a place of peace, justice, and fairness. Although they are so very grateful to be here, they also join us in uniting against brutality in any form. Wanting peace is something that we all have in common. Thank you again for letting me share this short update. We are all praying together to get through these trying times and to help our brothers and sisters from all over the world.
Good morning. My name is Paula France, and I am the director of the Global Institute of Lansing. I'm happy to be here with you this morning. GIL is a local nonprofit that helps adult refugees earn an accredited high school diploma. Our mission is to provide educational services to adult refugees that enable them to earn a high school diploma in an atmosphere of peace, respect, encouragement, and inspiration. At GIL, we believe that refugees are invaluable members of our community and as such deserve an accessible quality education. We aim to build a stronger, more inclusive community through engaging those in need and providing them a solid educational foundation so they can go on to post-secondary education or obtain gainful employment that allows them the opportunity to grow. Our students dream of purchasing homes in our community, starting businesses, and making Lansing their forever home. GIL takes refugee students who have aged out of high school or are too old to attend public school and enrolls them in an accredited online high school completion program. Through this online program, they are required to complete 24 credits to earn an accredited high school diploma. If a student previously attended high school in the United States, we will get their transcript so they can get transfer credit for the classes they've already taken. Our classroom is in the First Presbyterian Church in downtown Lansing. And until March of this year, our classroom was open 5 days a week and 2 evenings a week, which allowed students flexibility in coming to class while also working full-time and caring for their families and extended family members. Our classroom is staffed with volunteer teachers, and currently we have 18 volunteer teachers working with us. Our teachers work one-on-one with students, helping guide them through the class material, learn vocabulary and critical concepts, write essays, and the list goes on and on. Students work at their own pace, so we may have 15 students in the classroom working on 10 different classes at a time. This year, we received a new grant that allowed us to offer childcare 2 days a week for our students with children 5 years and younger. Since opening our classroom doors in the fall of 2010, we have enrolled 202 students, 38 of whom are currently enrolled and attending. And to date, we have 78 graduates of our program, with another group quickly approaching the finishing line. Almost all of our graduates have gone into community college, a four-year college, are working full-time, or are doing both. Our students come from a variety of backgrounds, ranging in ages from 18 to 61, and represent 23 different countries. I want to take a quick moment to recognize our amazing volunteer teaching staff. It is such an honor to work with them every day. Their commitment to our students comes straight from their hearts. They are kind, compassionate, patient, encouraging, and inspiring. They work with our students day in and day out because they believe in the importance of education. Not only do they teach, but they mentor and guide our students in so many other ways. Our amazing teachers have created an incredibly supportive and welcoming classroom environment, which has allowed our students this opportunity to work toward their dreams and earn their high school diploma. On average, our volunteer teachers donate over 2,500 hours of their time every year. While this is how GIL has operated since opening our classroom doors in 2010, everything changed on March 12th of this year when the governor signed the executive order closing schools due to the coronavirus pandemic. Out of concern for the safety of our students and teachers, we also closed our classroom for in-person learning. At first, we had hoped to only be closed for a few weeks, but then it became obvious that our classroom would be closed for longer. Under normal circumstances, our students are not allowed to take tests from home for a variety of reasons. However, with the closure being for more than a few weeks, we came up with a plan to allow our students to work from home and take tests so they can keep moving forward in their education. The first step was making sure our students had a computer at home, as well as reliable internet. We lent out laptops from our classroom for those students who did not have one at home. We helped students get connected to low-cost internet options, so they didn't have to rely on their cell phone hotspot to study and complete their work. A plan was implemented requiring students to complete additional assignments prior to taking any tests from home. And all students signed a formal student agreement which laid out all the new rules and procedures. And we made videos to help teach them about the new programs we would be using in addition to their online classes. While nothing beats in-person learning, we have done our best to create an environment that supports our students remotely. Our volunteer teachers have really stepped up and are working one-on-one with students over the phone, through Zoom, and by email. We hold weekly student Zoom meetings where we gather to ask questions and talk about life and what is happening in our community. We miss seeing everyone in the classroom, but we are making the best of the situation and are working hard to provide a quality education to our students. Even though it felt like life was put on hold back in March for many of us, most of our students had to continue working as they are essential workers. Some students were laid off and found navigating the unemployment system to be very frustrating, so they found new jobs very quickly. Additionally, back in April, a group of our students all tested positive for COVID-19. Thankfully, they have all recovered and are now back to work. The one beacon of light through all of this was seeing how our students and teachers came together to support one another. Early on, our teachers all on their own pooled money together to help our students who had been laid off or had tested positive for COVID-19. Through their generosity, we were able to pay rent and utilities, as well as money for food for all of our students affected either by unemployment or those who became ill. I know our students were so incredibly grateful for this help during such uncertain times. I am often asked, how can we help? Right now, we ask you to continue to hold our students and teachers in your prayers. There is still a lot of uncertainty going forward, and we ask you to pray for our program. We ask you to share our story with the greater community so more people can learn about the important work we are doing. Please follow us on social media because we will share there when we have specific needs. Also, this fall is our 10-year anniversary, and while we had planned on doing a large fundraising event, we are now looking to do more of a celebration. But plans are still on hold until we know we can do it safely. Tomorrow, Monday, June 15th, was supposed to be our graduation. Sadly, we had to postpone it until further notice. Our graduation ceremony is always a part of World Refugee Awareness Week, and even though we won't be having our graduation tomorrow, we wanted to do something to celebrate this special week. We have created a video called Where Are They Now? And we will be premiering it on our website and Facebook page tomorrow at 6 p.m. Some of our previous graduates made short videos talking about why they came to GIL and what they're doing now. They also offer words of encouragement and inspiration to our future graduates. I'd like to end by sharing a sneak peek of one of our graduates from last year. Arbab shares his story of why getting his high school diploma was so important to him and what his future plans are. I hope you'll check out the full video tomorrow night. Thank you for your continued support.
Hi, my name is Arbab Ibrahim. I came from Sudan 2015. And I'm now a student at LCC. I'm studying pre-medicine. And I'm going to apply medical school at Michigan State University at College of Human Medicine. Yeah, first time I came here, I didn't accept it in high school. I got rejected. So I found Global Institute of Lansing. I just took online classes there. I failed many classes, but I taught myself it's not over yet. I keep struggling, and keep getting succeeding in class, all the class. And then I just graduated 2019 and applied at LCC. I'm now at LCC student. So getting high school diploma is really important. Getting high school diploma is not you just getting the certificate, but it make you increasing your knowledge. Getting high school diploma, it can help you to solve complex problem. Getting high school diploma, it gonna give you new idea how to save your community. Getting high school diploma is not just certificate like what I said, but getting high school diploma is really, really important. It's gonna make you who you are. Getting high school diploma, it's gonna change your life from bottom to top level. Getting high school diploma, like I said, it's not just the certificate, but getting high school diploma is really, really important in your lifetime. It's gonna give you new idea. It's gonna give you a new opportunity to serve your community. It's gonna give you new idea to solve like complex problem, how to solve your problem when the people face challenges, and that also. This is what I have. So thank you guys so much.
Accept each other as Christ accepted us. Teach us as sister, brother, each person to embrace. Be present, Lord, among us and bring us to search for hope and faith. Teach us to care for people, for all, not just for some. To love them as we find them, or as Let your acceptance change us so that we may be moved in living situations to do the truth in love, to practice your acceptance until we know by heart the table of forgiveness and laughter's healing art. Lord, for today's encounters with all who are in need, who hunger for acceptance, for justice and for bread, we need new eyes for seeing, new hands for holding on. With your spirit, Lord, free us, make us one.
As we come to our offering today, I share that our church is proud to financially contribute to support refugee services at St. Vincent's and the Global Institute of Lansing. If you would like to send an increased amount for these, please designate accordingly. As Paula and the other leaders in Afar articulate, the biggest need now is to sustain the refugee services work through St. Vincent's. So let us share our gifts, our whole lives with the Holy God, who receives and blesses and uses our gifts for the repairing of the world. During this pandemic, our giving is different. We can mail checks to the church or give online. We also give with our prayers and our actions, night and day. Amen. Please join me in praying. Mighty Lord, as you guided the Israelites through the wilderness, be a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day for refugees in search of new hope and new life. As you brought the Israelites out of bondage to freedom, bring refugees out of persecution to safety. As you protected the Israelites through 40 years in the desert, protect those who languish for years in refugee camps. Wipe away their tears of sorrow, that their mourning may give way to joyous hope. Put an end to warfare and tyranny, that some may return home without fear of violence. Open the doors of safer nations, that some may find new homes in a new land. Rebuild lives, that they may enjoy the fruit of labors in peace, that they may be able to sustain their families. Revive their hope, that they might face a future with promise. Shine your grace upon them, that they might know your love. Strengthen bonds of friendship and family, and inspire your church to welcome the stranger, that together we might build communities of hope where strangers become neighbors and friends and brothers and sisters. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And in these days, we pray for all who suffer from the evils of racism, hatred, and dehumanization. May we do our own work to root out the ideologies of white supremacy and the ways that it has distorted us and the systems in which we live. We pray for Black lives, Indigenous lives, people of color. We pray for our LGBTQ sisters and brothers. May we listen and may we learn. May all find shelter. May all know that they are valued and precious.
May we work together to remove barriers to jobs, education, food, healthcare, and faith communities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. We pray for the dying and those who grieve. We pray for our world in this time of pandemic, and for all on the front lines and those especially at risk. We pray for ourselves, our neighbors, and our enemies. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our church and the church throughout the world. May we be faithful witnesses in these hours. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for leaders and policymakers in our communities, our state, our nation, and our world. We pray for wisdom, clarity, and courage. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray together the prayer Jesus taught, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, dear people of God,
fear not. For lo, God goes with you always, before you, behind you, above you, beneath you, and within you. And watch and listen, for God is also within the strangers we meet. Go in peace, dear ones. Go in love. Amen.